One day after Berlusconi's court appearance, the lower house is voting to pass the immunity bill. Berlusconi's attorneys are present to vote on the bill. The debate has dragged on all day, as more than 70 amendments are considered, a stalling tactic of the opposition. Outside, a crowd is gathering to protest the bill's passage. The immunity bill passes. It applies to any crimes committed before or during Berlusconi's public service. The balloons to represent equality before the law are released into the Rome sky.
Now we don't need to change the constitution. All the rules, the appearances, the procedures can be respected. That's unnecessary because the power of television, which did not exist in Hitler's or Mussolini's time, combined to the power of radio and combined to the power of the press, you can have democracy as an empty shell. The substance is gone, or is going.
On July 1st, just 13 days after the immunity law passed, Prime Minister Berlusconi took over the rotating presidency of the European Union. At first, his charm seemed to be winning over his audience. But just 24 hours into his presidency, a German member of the European Parliament questioned his conflicts of interest and the immunity law, and the honeymoon was over.
So che in Italia c'è un produttore che sta montando un film sui campi di concentramento nazisti. La suggerirò per il ruolo di Capò. Lei è perfetto. Se questa è la forma di democrazia che intendete usare per chiudere le parole del Presidente del Consiglio europeo, sembrate turisti della democrazia, dei turisti della democrazia.
His remarks in Strasbourg were not heard on Rai's leading news program. It has been a productive summer for Silvio Berlusconi. His trial has been postponed indefinitely. He's immune from further prosecution. This month, The Economist magazine challenged Berlusconi again to defend himself against a long list of unanswered questions about his financial and political past.
Alexander Stilla, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Let's talk about Berlusconi's power over the TV. Directly or indirectly, he controls 90% of the TV in Italy. But if you're an Italian sitting in Italy watching television, do you get objective news? Do you learn about the truth about the Italian economy, Italian politics?
Well, to give you an idea, I mean, if this matters during election coverage, and I think we all appreciate how important that is, if you watch one of Berlusconi's channels, the anchorman on one of his channels wept with joy when Berlusconi was elected on air. I've watched programs in which he's just literally insulted the political opposition, called them liars, called them enemies, called them communists, called them all sorts of things. I saw his main political adversary was given a little soundbite in which he was portrayed at a fish market talking about how to cook fish instead of talking about the political issues of the day. You know, that may seem laughable to many people, and many Italians will tell you, oh, I actually watched that for amusement. But it's not so funny if you consider that, for example, there are statistics that show that the people who watch Berlusconi's channels vote overwhelmingly for his party. You realize that control of television does translate into votes and translates into power in ways that should make, I think, everyone uneasy.
Let's talk about the specific charges of corruption and bribery that have been made against Berlusconi. Do you think the average Italian regards these charges as outrageous, or do they somehow come to expect business leaders to bribe the tax man, for example, to avoid paying taxes?
Well, I think it's true that one reason why there's been a high level of toleration for Berlusconi and his legal problems is that many Italians do skirt the law, in many cases feel they're forced to skirt the law by excessive regulation. There are something like 70,000 or 90,000 laws in Italy and only 5,000 in France or Germany.
Tax laws.
Just laws in general. Their life is very regulated. But I think that what many Italians don't know, because it hasn't been publicized, is that the kind of bribery and the kind of corner cutting that Berlusconi and his company has done is on an entirely different scale.
That's not being reported to the Italian people in detail.
It is reported, but it's, for example, never explained on TV. So that, for example, what you'll get on TV is Berlusconi or one of his lawyers saying, "This is outrageous. They've invented an entire case and it's based on no evidence." And then a journalist doesn't intervene and say, "Actually, the evidence is this, and there are two ways of looking at this case." You only get, he's been accused of bribing a judge, a contradiction of that charge by saying it's invented, and no independent analysis of what the facts are.
Do you regard the newspapers, as opposed to the television, as free in Italy? And haven't they been some of the primary critics of Berlusconi?
Well, they have, but it's interesting. Berlusconi doesn't much worry about newspapers that are, or magazines that are sort of clearly on the left. He knows that their readers will never vote for him. Where Berlusconi has dedicated his attention are in the print media that have a broad mainstream centrist readership.
Like we saw in the film.
The Corriere della Sera is the prime example. La Stampa, the newspaper of Turin, is the other. They are big centrists. It's like the Washington Post and the New York Times here in Italy. And he has been able to exercise a lot of indirect control of those papers.
But can't you read in Corriere della Sera today, tomorrow, next week, strong criticism of Berlusconi?
You would think that would happen in any in a naturally free press, and that has not happened in Italy. So that as a result, the average sort of center voter doesn't quite know what to believe. I think actually, if they examine them closely, they'd be quite shocked.
Well, we found that very interesting in the film, that you had his lawyers, his very own lawyers in his trial, going back as parliamentarians to change the laws to his advantage. Could that happen in any other country, or is that pretty unique to Italy?
Maybe somewhere in South America, but I'm not aware of it happening in any advanced democracy. It's a very, very anomalous and peculiar situation. They literally would spend 2 or 3 days a week in Milan defending Berlusconi in their black lawyerly robes, and then fly back to Rome, and then rewrite the laws that would then short-circuit the very trials in which he was a defendant. And that happens in all sorts of areas, including business areas, economic legislation.
How much do you think the Berlusconi model is playing out in other parts of the world?
Well, I think the thing that makes Berlusconi a really interesting, important figure is that he crystallizes in a very dramatic way problems and issues that exist in all modern democracies now, in every society, including ours. Money, media, and political power are very closely connected. He's understood, maybe more than any politician, that if something doesn't appear on television, it doesn't exist. You look at the recent decision of Arnold Schwarzenegger to enter the race for governorship. The fact that he is a celebrity, a TV personality, movie personality with an enormous amount of money makes him a player from one day to the next. I don't think people have fully processed how deeply television has changed the political process in our own world. Political parties have become vestiges of what they were, and individuals and large amounts of money can leapfrog over that process. In Italy, it exists in a much kind of neuter and cruder way, but I think people everywhere in this country as well have a very dismaying feeling that politics is going over their heads, is being decided by wealthy interests that don't take them into consideration and are bending the legislative process in their own behalf. People get used to that and say, well, if they can do that in Italy, then what's the big deal if I do it to a lesser degree here in France or in England or in this country? And so I think it's setting precedents that are unhealthy for democracy.